This video covers the Pebble Traveling Salesman Problem Task, or TSP task. Here's just an image of what the task looks like. The Traveling Salesman Problem is a classic problem in computer science, and it's about trying to find the shortest path between a bunch of points on a map. And let's see, so it's been studied by computer scientists for many years and to try to develop better algorithms for doing this. But maybe in recent years it's become a more important problem understanding human problem solving. Now, people can't solve this task perfectly well, but they can't always solve it perfectly, but they do it in interesting ways. In fact, unlike algorithms that usually scale inefficiently as you increase the number of points, people scale very efficiently, so they produce pretty good results. So usually the optimal results are within 10%, or the results people produce are within 10% of the length of the optimal. And here you can see for these points, someone did a crossover like this. It was 15% longer than the optimal. The best route was this outline here. So I've been interested in this task for a while and implemented a version of this a long time ago, but hadn't released it as part of Pebble until recently. And part of that was a paper I published covering this task and some of the history of it. And so this paper is in the Journal of Problem Solving 2015 with some of my former students. And it really covers the Pebble task, data from the Pebble task, normative data on some of the problems, and a nice history of some of the different methods people have used to collect it. So if you're doing, even if you're not using Pebble's version, if you're making decisions about this, how to collect the task, this seems, there are things that can matter, how you allow people to make the path, whether you make allowing them to edit it, back up, and things like that. And so I have a nice review here of some of the methods people have used. So if you want to use the Pebble version, it's pretty easy to use. If you download and install Pebble, you'll start up and you'll get a launcher like this, and the Traveling Salesman Problem task is in battery. You can scroll down to TSP, and you'll see this picture. So if we click on this, let's see, there are first start by just running it to see what happens. So instructions are given over here, and this is the area where the problem will be. And down here it will give a little feedback about how well you did. It always starts with a few practice problems of size 6. Size 6 are usually people can get these right 100% of the time. You can see that you get a little visual and auditory feedback, and then it tells you efficiency of 1, which means you were 0% lower than optimal. Your goal is to have a low efficiency of 1 is the smallest you can get. The green line shows the best solution. Click to continue. So that's just the practice. Okay, now we're going to do a few more practice ones, and so do this. Okay, it gives that feedback. Maybe I do this, and then I realize I can't. I did a mistake, so I can. Depending on the settings, I can back up. And notice I don't have to click on the last one; it auto completes it because there's no other thing you can click on. So that was done to prevent people from sort of getting to that point and not knowing what to do next. So we'll auto-complete the last one. It also lets you, it also selects the point to start on. That's not necessarily the only way. Some people, when they do this task, let the person start on whatever point they want. So as you can see, I'm giving the inefficiency, the true length, how long your length actually was, and a time. So let's say I want to do this. You can see now that the green is the best. The red is what I did, and even though it was bad, it was only 3% longer than optimal. It gives me that feedback here. Okay, now remember we're measuring both how efficient your path is and how fast you solve the problem. So let's try to do this. Now it gets a little trickier. This is a larger problem. So usually, okay, so I did not get it right, but it was within less than 1% longer. So it was actually almost a crapshoot which one I really wanted to do, and it might have been hard to see visually. So I get this feedback here. I'm not sure which way to go. Okay, that one was perfect. And then it starts getting larger. Because I've practiced this, I've done these a lot, but I still don't get them correct 100%. See, I did a little deviation here, and that was still within 1% of optimal. Okay, so it's going to continue for a number of problems, a fixed number of problems that are set by the experimenter. So the problems available for this are all in the tours folder, and there's so this, unlike some tasks, these aren't generated by random values. There's a few reasons for that. You don't want any points that are too close to each other, look like they're overlapping. And also, in order to know how bad you're doing, you need to know what the optimal is, and that's not a trivial thing to do, especially for large problems. So I'm going to open up this tours folder to show you how these are saved. So that those first six item problems are saved here, example six, and there's actually 10 and 20 example problems, and they're saved in a format that was originally generated by, I think, the Concord solver. And so they're saved in an order that solves it correctly. So if you, or it solves it according to that solver. So you can create your own. It has labels for each node. The first column is city, that's probably irrelevant. The third and fourth column are the positions, and the fifth column happens to be zero in these cases. So really, you could create your own if you wanted and just generate these third and fourth columns so that there are specific problems in the order you want to solve. In fact, if you put them in an order that you, a random order, it'll still work. It'll just compare the person's solution to whatever order, the solution of whatever order that happens in, and so it'll connect the last one to the first one. And so it'll look like a mess otherwise. So all of the logic of what the best answer is stored within the order of this file. So many of these 201, 203, are ones I have used for many years and tested multiple times. And if you go to the paper about this, you can see that there's size 10, 20, and 30. And we do an evaluation of each of the different problems. These are 10 or 15 problems in each problem size, and they each correspond to problems in this data set. And here's a one that shows all the different problems that we used. This is a small size set of examples, and these are the ones that best correlated with the total. So these are the ones when you look at how inefficient people were as an individual measure, this best predicted a person's performance on the whole set. So these are the ones that have greatest psychometric properties. And maybe we can see one that we did. I think we did that one. Every one of these smaller sets of problems is, we have both test retest numbers, part whole test efficiencies, ICC correlations, a lot of psychometric properties. So you can guess, at least for a small data set that I collected, that these are reasonably good problems to use. Here's test retest correlations of these problems, I guess, across people. These are two test retests for a bunch of them put together. For problems across people. So this is problem one, size 30, problem one, and when it was done twice by the same people, they got relatively similar average efficiencies. And then in the appendix, we have some code for creating the data that we want based on Concord Windows GUI solver, and detailed sort of histograms of how inefficient people's solutions were for all the different problems. And here's more detail for all 30 plus problems that are available in here. So these can be used to select your own tests or to figure out exactly what you want to do. And they're the same problems that are available in here. So that's one thing that you might want to be able to do is create tests with your own problems or a subset of these. And by default, let's see, if we go to edit the parameter settings, these are the different parameter settings available, and it uses a listing of problems that are saved in this subset.csv file. So let me exit without saving. I will open this folder, and we can see that there's a subset.csv file here, and if we look at it, this contains a set of files that describe the different problems that you want to run. And you could use a different subset, create your own, and put these in here as well. This ends up being information that's saved out to the data file. So I think this is a label. So the second column is a label that you want to put in rather than the file name. The third column is a problem size, and you could use maybe larger problems if you wanted to. And the fourth one, this is probably some type of efficiency score that's in there as well, or a reliability score that comes from that paper. So if you want a different set, you can edit this and use different problems, either different problems that are in here, or create your own new problems and put them in here and edit this to use it. Okay, so back to the parameter settings. We can also fix a number of things about the display and things like that. So I can make the target larger. This might be, if you have 100 problems, 25 pixels might be too big. But it makes it easier to click on when the radius of the targets are 25 pixels. So this is something that you might want to change a little bit. This is whether you should do those practice trials. So if you have multiple rounds, maybe you only want to practice on the first time. And so you can have one session with practice, another session without. This controls sort of the size of that window. So if you want a larger one or a smaller one, you can control sort of where the upper left and the size of the window that the problems are in. It doesn't, so the problems that you create have to fit in a 500 by 500 window then. If this is 500 by 500, if you create one with locations that are outside of it, it's gonna, probably it'll show up off that grid. So the next one is trials per size. If you don't use file, then it will randomly select from the complete set in that folder, and these can control the random ones that you want to use. That's probably not a wise idea, because you want better control over exactly which problems you're doing. This is a really easy task to do on a touch screen, and so you may want to use a touch screen, and so this just controls the label on the screen. Instead of saying click, you can say touch, so that they're not trying to touch and then you're telling them to click. There's a couple of visual feedback. We had the beat, we heard the beat playing, but you can also have a flash. Let's turn that on to see what it looks like. And we can also say, should we always start everyone at the same node, or should we start people at different nodes? So it's the same problem, might be more difficult if it starts in one place versus another. And so you could test that. I think all of the norm data start with the same node, and so you may want to keep that, but we'll just change that for the moment. Maybe we'll try making these smaller, and we'll turn off intro. So now we have a custom parameter set. Instead of the default, we'll use this custom one. All right, so let's try this parameter setting. And so now we didn't get these start demonstrations, but now we go straight into a tough problem. Let's see, how am I going to do this? Okay, you can see that now there's the points are a lot smaller, but also there's a little large circle flash whenever you click it. That's really useful for if you're doing touch screen because it's hard to know if, well, both the auditory and visual are useful because it's hard to know whether you actually clicked on it if your finger's covering it. So you can't see it change from red to gray. And so either of those, you know, that flash is usually big enough to for you to see when your finger's covering it. And so even though I was a little worried I did get 100, a 1.0 efficiency, I did perfectly in this. But also the point size is a lot smaller. This might be sort of a performance manipulation. If you make this harder, people actually might do better because it takes them longer, slows them down a little bit, and they think about it more. So you could edit those things. I don't think the size of this thick line path is adjustable. All right, so that's you know, some of the parameters you can edit on this. Now you can also change instructions a little bit and or translate them. And so for all the Pebble battery tests, or almost all of them, you can hit, once you have this selected, you can hit this to translate it, and it'll bring up this dialog. And so if you want to change this, even in the English, you know, maybe you want this, please alert experimenter, or maybe this is a series of tests, and so you want to say, please continue on to the next test. And you can edit any of these things. And if you're doing it in English, you can edit the English, or you can make a new language and then translate this for each one. Then we hit save file. It will automatically save that in translations. If you do translate this, please send it to me so I can put it in the test battery for other people to use. All right, so now we maybe edited the instructions a little bit. We've covered the parameter settings, we've covered the tours. Let's look at what the data are going to look like. So I'm going to open this up. I've done a lot of different practice. First of all, there's this log file that will tell me time and date every time it started, and you can see how I never actually completed any of these. I think if you complete the whole test, it will also have a stop time. Now this can be useful to track down problems and errors and mistakes. So it looks like we're running with these guys. There are three files created. This one will give some type of report at the end that will write in text how the person did overall. but this is a detailed file, and so it creates a CSV file that has every single click, so a bunch for every problem, the point, x, y coordinates, where the click actually was, so how close to the center you can calculate. And various aspects about this. So you're probably, this is probably more detailed than you need unless you're really wanting to look at aspects of how it is solved, and then you can get the actual path a person gives. The summary file should be just one row per problem. So here's this problem, and I see the start time for everyone, how long it took to make the first click. So here you can see it took about 7 seconds of me looking at the problem before I made that first click, how long it took in total, what the optimal length was, and what the observed length and the efficiency. So this could give more of a summary level per trial, instead of each click for the for every solution, which I get in the other file. So that pretty much covers all the aspects of the Pebble TSP task. So go ahead and download it and look for the paper in the Journal of Problem Solving if you want to learn more information. And thank you for watching.